Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, today we start our first class on Surah Al-Kahf. Today, inshallah, we'll talk about the virtue of Surah Tabarak, Surah Al-Mulk. And inshallah, today we'll start with the virtue of Surah Al-Mulk and the tafsir of the first two ayat of Surah Al-Mulk. So to begin with, my dear brothers and sisters, the Surah Al-Mulk, it includes 1,316 letters. And we know that reciting one letter from the Quran gives you 10 hasanat or 10 good deeds. So basically that means if you recite Surah Al-Mulk every day, and that takes you only about 5 minutes, subhanAllah, this will give you about 13,160 hasanat, which is a lot. If we think about how much time we spend on our phone, how much time we spend on TV, subhanAllah, imagine on the Day of Judgment when you open your book of good deeds and you see that for each day you spend like five hours on your phone and only 5 minutes reciting Surah Tabarak or Surah Al-Mulk. Or imagine if a person sees that the 5 hours they spent on their phone or on their TV or on their computer, they're actually watching something haram or doing sins. So compare that 5 hours to 5 minutes. And some people, unfortunately, don't even spend that 5 minutes to recite the Quran a day. But every single day they are on their phone, they are on TV, they are watching something haram, etc. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. So we need to balance, we need to remove our bad deeds that we're doing by doing good deeds. And the least that we can do is to at least spend 5 minutes, especially that it's right before we go to bed, so that if that's the last that we're going to sleep, the last time that we're going to wake up, at least we ended our book of good deeds with reciting Surah Tabarak or Surah Al-Mulk. And as we know, subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are many ahadith about it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Surah Al-Mulk is a mani'ah min adhab al-qabr, which means that it is the preventer or the protector from the punishment in the grave. In another hadith that is considered hasan, authentic, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there is a surah that interceded for the person who memorized it, that it actually got them out of the hellfire and sent them to Jannah. So imagine on the Day of Judgment, subhanAllah, some people will need just one hasanah, just one good deed, in order to, for their scale of good deeds to overweigh the scale of bad deeds. But imagine if somebody recites Surah Al-Mulk every single day before they sleep and they get 13,000 or more hasanat. Imagine how happy they will be on the Day of Judgment. Also think about it. It has 30 ayat. And the Prophet ﷺ said on the Day of Judgment, when we're going to Jannah, the people who memorize the Quran, Allah will say to them, اقرأ وارتقي. Or the angels will say to them, اقرأ وارتقي means recite and go up in rank, go up. So for 30 ayat that you memorize, you can go 30 higher levels in Jannah. Imagine if you're applying to a job and they tell you that we have 30 positions in this company, right? The lowest one gets maybe $1,000 salary, right? But the highest one is number 30. You get $30,000 salary. Which job would you want to get? The first one, or would you want to get the one that's in the 30th level or the 30th rank? Same thing with Surah Al-Mulk or the Quran in general. The more you memorize the Quran, the higher you go in rank in Jannah. May Allah make us of those who go to the highest rank in Jannah. Ameen. So in addition to that, memorizing and learning the Quran makes you one of the best people, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the authentic hadith, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you are those who learn the Quran and teach it. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who memorize the Quran and never forget it, and make us of those who spend their time memorizing and reading the Quran and understanding it and learning about it, and make the Quran a shafi, or intercessor for us on the Day of Judgment. So now we start with the tafsir of the first two ayat of Surah Al-Mulk. Inshallah, I'll try to make this brief so that you can have time to study and it will be easy for you to remember, inshallah, when you're doing your homework or when you get questions for homework. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says, Tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulku wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. The word tabarak is coming from the root for the word barakah, which is blessing. We all know the word barakah, and we all say barakallahu fiqh, may Allah bless you, right? But the word barakah linguistically means increase in goodness, right? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the hadith narrated by the Sahabi named Sakhr, actually the Sahabi, when he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying the hadith, or making the dua, Allahumma barik li ummati fi bukuriha, oh Allah bless or put barakah in the morning for my nation. So the morning time basically. So this Sahabi Sakhr, when he heard that hadith, and he was a businessman, he would always start his business in the morning, and subhanAllah, he became extremely rich because of that. So barakah here is increase of goodness. It could be increase of wealth, increase of children, it creates increase of happiness, increase of all kinds of goodness that you could think of. And the word tabarak here, when Allah says tabarak, Allah is praising himself. And he's saying that the barakah of Allah is showering, or the goodness of Allah is increasing and showering the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you think about it, everything in the creation in this universe is in need of the goodness of Allah, is always receiving the goodness of Allah. SubhanAllah, imagine if the sun doesn't rise tomorrow, right? What are we going to do? Imagine if the moon doesn't come on time in the same place, etc. So everything in the universe, the breathing, that, you know, every day we're breathing so many times that we don't even feel the blessing of breathing, the blessing of the heartbeat, etc. All of these blessings that we cannot enumerate are happening every single day. So the creation of Allah, the entire universe, is being showered by the blessings of Allah. And unfortunately, a lot of us are not appreciative, and we don't even realize it or even think about it. So Allah here is praising himself, saying, Tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. So the goodness or the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showering his people, his creation with goodness. And then he describes himself, alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. So the one in whose hand rests the dominion or the kingdom or the ownership of the entire universe. So this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us about himself, that he is the owner of everything that we can see. Everything that we can imagine is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the fact that we know that Allah owns everything makes us think that we should never ask anyone other than Allah. Unfortunately, some people make dua to Prophet Muhammad asking for help. Some people make dua to a dead righteous person and ask him for help, or ask him for, you know, to heal their kid, etc. But subhanAllah, this is not okay. This is shirk, actually. And we should only make dua to the one who actually owns the things that we need. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, and he has the ability to do everything. So not only is he the owner of everything, because you could be the owner of a lot of things, but you cannot do everything. For example, you could be the owner of all the treasures on earth, but you cannot bring yourself happiness, right? A lot of the rich people, they cannot bring themselves happiness. So Allah is reminding us, not only is he the owner of everything in this universe, but also he is able to do anything. So if you are sick, yes, money cannot buy you. Sometimes money cannot cure you, right? But Allah can cure you. Money cannot bring you happiness. Allah can bring you happiness. Money cannot bring you children if you are aqim or something. Allah can bring you children if you need. So this is something that we need to keep in mind, that Allah has the power to do everything. And we have this faith in our heart when we're making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alladhi khalaqa al-mawta wal-hayata. So it is he who created death and life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created death and life. And why did he create death and life? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, to test you, which one amongst you is the best, or the one that will do the best of deeds. So death and life are in themselves a test for us sometimes. For example, if somebody you love so much dies, you know, that is a test for you. Life itself is full of tests, right? And subhanAllah, this is something very important that we need to teach our children. And our children might ask us, like, why did Allah create me here? Why didn't Allah give me a choice or something like that? Or why is Allah testing me? We need to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us all a choice. when we before we come on this earth, Allah took from the children of Adam, from the back of Adam, every human being that will ever live on this earth, and He made them bear witness that He's our Lord. And also He offered all of His creation the free will, and whoever accepted the free will knew that they were going to be tested with it, and the humans and the jinn accepted the free will, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created life, created death in order to test us, and which one of us will be the ones who do the best of deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who do the best of deeds. And then this life, subhanAllah, if we pass that test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in this life, then we go to another life where we are living in eternal happiness, as we all know, in Jannat al-Firdaus. But if we fail and we disbelieve in Allah, knowing that Allah is the truth, we end up going to hellfire. May Allah protect us all from the hellfire. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ. It is He, the Almighty. He is the Almighty and the most forgiving. Why is Allah choosing these two names here in this context? Al-Aziz, the Almighty, meaning the one who can never be defeated, or the one whose will can never be stopped, the one who's all-powerful. Basically, so Allah is reminding us here that we have a test, and there is a punishment, and no one can stop the punishment of Allah if we end up failing that test. But at the same time, He uses the name Al-Ghafoor, the most forgiving, which means if you fail that test, but you repent in this life, Allah is always most forgiving, and He will accept your repentance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding of the Quran. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه الغفور الرحيم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.